From a distance, hotels seem like a simple business. As a guest, you pay a nightly rate for a room of your choice. The better the location, the more that you pay every night. The more upscale the hotel is, the nicer your stay will be with better service and amenities, like business centers, gyms, fire pits, pools, and jacuzzis. During your stay, you can pay more for add-ons like breakfast, shoe shining, room service, or even laundry. After you check out, you're charged for everything. The hotel cleans up the room and rents it out to the next guest. Rinse and repeat. Hotels have high fixed and variable costs. Let's say you run the luxury JW Marriott in downtown Los Angeles. That's 21 floors, 900 rooms, complete with a full-service spa, fitness center, outdoor pool, meeting room, rooftop bar, and valet. Let's say the hotel is now in low season and only 30% of the rooms are occupied. But the rooms still have to be cleaned, hallways still have to be vacuumed, the lobby has to be kept tidy, and counters have to be wiped. Housekeeping still has to be on hand to deliver toothpaste, towels, and laundry upon request. The bartender still has to be ready to take orders and pour drinks, even if no one's at the rooftop. The same goes for the valet, the spa masseuse, the front desk, the pool guys, the doormen, and the security guards. The nicer the hotel, the more amenities that are offered, but the higher the direct operating cost becomes with the additional labor, materials, and overhead. Hotels operate on economies of scale and economies of scope. Their objective is to achieve consistent volume and to keep new guests flowing in after the prior guests check out. This is why hotels aggressively slash prices in the low season and then hike the room prices as high as possible during the high season. Low season is between November and March. That's the end of the school year, when businesses tend to slow down, everyone winds down to Christmas, people travel back home to their families, and winters generally reach their coldest levels. Few people will want to take a vacation during wind chills, ice storms, or heavy snows on the East Coast. High season, in comparison, is between May and August, so think of Miami during the summer, where everyone wants to go spend time on a beach, when the weather is at its nicest, when students break from school, and families go on vacation. If we go back to that JW Marriott in downtown LA, all those additional amenities that we mentioned, like the spa, the pool, the bar, and the valet, are all tools to increase the average guest bill. Even though these amenities and the overall hotel is a seasonal business, they'll go through their slow periods in the low season where they might end up operating in the red, the loss is generally made up during the high season. Selling drinks, food, pedicures, valet, along with the optionality of pools and gyms and meeting rooms, are all levers for a hotel to increase its revenue and customer lifetime value while slowly increasing the room price. If you set too high of a room price, people will just book another comparable on an aggregator like Priceline, Expedia, or Trivago. If you set too low of a room price, the rooms will sell out quickly, but the hotel still has plenty of ways to make money off the guests once they check in. But not every hotel is a five-star luxury building, and not everyone is willing to spend hundreds of dollars every night. Luxury hotel rooms account for less than 2% of all available hotel rooms in the United States. The hotel industry categorizes hotels under four main types: economy, mid-scale, upscale, and luxury. The type of hotel that you go to dictates how much you should expect to pay per night, the quality and breadth of service you should expect to receive, and the amenities that are available on site. If we look at the leading hotels today, there are really five main players. These five corporations own entire portfolios of recognizable hotels and brands that span across all these different hotel types. Let's start with the most well-known player in Hilton. Hilton's luxury brands are the prestigious Waldorf Astoria, LXR, and Conrad hotels, which are all located in landmark destinations like Dubai, Turkey, Rome, and New York City. But as legendary and as prestigious as these luxury brands are, these hotels account for less than 5% of the total hotel rooms in Hilton's portfolio. Hilton's moneymakers are in its upscale and mid-scale brands. The Hilton is the company's flagship hotel that provides everything from event spaces to restaurants and bars in their lobbies. DoubleTree is famous for its warm chocolate chip cookies that it serves guests upon check-in, is also another well-known upscale Hilton hotel that's mainly targeted towards business travelers. Garden Inn and Embassy Suites are other examples of leading upscale Hilton hotels. In the mid-scale category, Hilton owns the respected Hampton Inn, which also attracts leisure travelers with its complimentary hot breakfast and waffles. Hotels make money as a function of how many rooms that they have, and Hilton in 2021 grossed $6 billion with a little over 1 million rooms worldwide. Before the pandemic, Hilton was earning $8 to $9 billion consistently every year. But despite their first mover advantage and their fame, Hilton is only good enough these days to take second place when it comes to revenue and total rooms available. First place goes to Marriott. Marriott has the highest market cap and grosses nearly 3 times as much revenue as Hilton. Marriott's luxury brands include the Ritz-Carlton, St. Regis, JW Marriott, and the W. Its other upscale concepts include the Sheraton, the Westin, and the Marriott hotels. What's really unique about the Marriott portfolio is that they actually have the mature mid-scale market share that Hilton lacks. Marriott owns trusted brands in the mid-scale category like Courtyard, Fairfield, Aloft, and Residence Inn. Marriott grossed $14 billion in 2021 across 1.5 million rooms and was the undisputed industry leader with the most revenue and rooms available worldwide. Before COVID, Marriott was grossing $20 billion a year. If Marriott is in first place and Hilton is in second, then third place goes to Intercontinental Hotel Group. Intercontinental Hotel Group, or IHG for short, is based in Europe, but their portfolio contains plenty of recognizable American brands. IHG's luxury portfolio is spearheaded by the Regent and Six Senses, which are located in places like the Maldives, Fiji, and Portugal. IHG owns Crowne Plaza, as well as Holiday Inn, and the company grossed $2.9 billion in 2021 across 900,000 hotel rooms. Before the pandemic, IHG's annual revenue was around $4 to $5 billion every year. In fourth place is Hyatt. Hyatt's portfolio boasts top-end luxury brands such as Grand Hyatt, Park Hyatt, and Destination. For the upscale market, Hyatt owns Hyatt Regency, Hyatt Place, Hyatt House, and Hyatt Hotel. Hyatt grossed $3 billion in 2021, which puts the company on par with IHG, but is also half of what Hilton makes every year. Hyatt caters more towards business travelers, and the company's results in that regard are really impressive. Hyatt has less than 300,000 hotel rooms worldwide, which is a third of IHG, a third of Hilton, and a fifth of Marriott's scale. But to generate $3 billion off of so few rooms speak to how successful Hyatt has been in cornering the upscale business travel market. Before the COVID pandemic, Hyatt grossed $4 to $5 billion every year. In fifth place is Wyndham. While all these other players are duking it out over the high-end market, Wyndham is the quiet player that chooses to sit at an entirely different poker table. They specialize in mid-scale and economy hotels. Super 8, Travelodge, Microtel, and Days Inn are all well-known budget hotels that are in Wyndham's portfolio and targeted for value-oriented travelers. For economy hotels, free coffee and high-speed internet are the extent of the amenities. These economy hotels are simple, affordable, functional, and widespread. Wyndham also owns reputable mid-scale hotels such as La Quinta, Ramada, and Baymont. In 2021, Wyndham grossed $1.5 billion across 800,000 rooms, and before the pandemic, their gross revenue was clocking in at around $1.5 to $2 billion every year. Then came a little startup called Airbnb. As this tech company began to pick up momentum and funding in the early 2010s, a narrative began to take shape.
Why stay in a hotel room when you can instead rent an Airbnb condo or home?
Here's the kitchen. It's all newly remodeled, all new appliances, farmhouse sinks.
One reason for Airbnb's surging popularity is the chance to rent a whole house for the price of a hotel room.
It is not just a game changer, it's a huge game changer. The numbers are staggering. Imagine this, 25 million people booking rooms through Airbnb, and they're not just rooms. You can book everything from a Winnebago to, they've got 600 castles on their list. So the variety and the diversity is great. It's changing the name because you've got $13 billion in market valuation of just Airbnb alone that surpasses already the market valuation of companies like Intercontinental Hotels.
Airbnb is fundamentally changing the hotel industry.
Airbnb's gross bookings last year were $240 million, according to Privco. That's approaching Marriott's $1 billion, Starwood's $2 billion, Hyatt at $2 billion, and Hilton at $4 billion.
That's a big deal. And Airbnb's growth is at the expense of hotels. A Boston University study found that for every 1% increase in Airbnb's business, the rest of the hotel industry falls by 5 basis points. And think about it. Airbnb's growth is unconstrained by limits of real estate or capital.
Even to this day, hotel executives can't get through interviews without being asked about Airbnb. But what's interesting is that their collective response and position has been measured and consistent over the years.
Well, I think the disruptor that people think of first for the hotel space is Airbnb. But I would talk about two others as well. One would be online travel agents, which have been in place now for 10 to 15 years. Expedia, Priceline, Rakuten, Ctrip in China, a number of different players. And then the Googles and Amazons and Apples of the world, who have these extraordinary technology platforms and the ability to monetize them in ways which are pretty profound. They all pose threats to us. They are different kinds of threats. I think Airbnb, because it's the newest, captures the most attention. But in some respects is maybe the least threatening. And I don't mean to suggest that they're not a disruptor and they're not relevant. They are a big player, and I think they're here for a long time. But they are increasingly getting to a place where they are selling dedicated units on their site, as opposed to the guest room in somebody's occupied home, which is where it started, a classic shared economy. That classic shared economy is a different experience than a hotel room. And some people are going to be drawn to that because it's local and it seems individual, doesn't seem institutional in any respect. And you can understand that. But when it's a dedicated unit, then it's simply a question of, all right, what's the location? What's the price? What's the product look like? How well is it cared for? That's the competition we've been having for decades. And I think in many respects, that competition, while worthy and threatening, is not a wholly different kind of competition than we've had in the past.
Is Airbnb a threat to the established hotel industry?
I would not position them as a threat. They are players within our market, even though they're not really direct players because they only offer an online platform. We are we offering accommodation. They don't. They just list companies right. in their database to be able to offer accommodation. So I would not really call them a threat at this point, but they are a growing player that right. we need to be looking at in detail in terms of how are they playing and yeah. is within the rules of the game.
I do not think it's a real competitor to us. So if you think about what we do, it's something different than what they do. And I think we coexist with them quite well. We deliver a high quality, consistent product with the amenities wrapped in service, with all the technology, loyalty, and people pay us generally a big premium for that because they, you know, they want that level of consistent, high quality experience. What they do is something different. What they're doing is by definition, you know, can't have the consistency and the quality and the products and the amenities that are tailor fit because it's just something different. But it doesn't mean it's bad. It just means it's satisfying a different kind of trip occasion. So if you look at the numbers, even, you know, pre-COVID, we were coexisting quite well. We were at the peak levels of performance at a time, you know, where they were growing leaps and bounds, and we weren't really seeing significant competitive threat as a result.
Cost is the biggest barrier to scale in the hotel industry. It takes on average 2 to 3 years to build a new hotel. The upfront cost for design, permits, and construction can range from $30 million to $130 million, depending on location and category. These estimates don't even include the cost of the land. Since these numbers are publicly shared by nearly every hotel giant, it's no secret how cost prohibitive and expensive it is to grow your market share in the hotel industry. Airbnb's innovation is on the supply side. Anyone around the world can list and monetize their room, apartment, or house with just a few steps on Airbnb's website. The company's business value is to serve as a trusted platform between travelers and hosts. Discovery, communication, and transactions between both parties all occur on Airbnb. Hosts set their own prices for their own listings, they provide service, and they accept travelers in whatever way that they see fit. As a middleman, Airbnb charges service fees to both guests and hosts as a percentage of their total reservation cost. Airbnb's advantage is that as a platform, the company doesn't own, lease, manage, or maintain any physical real estate. Hosts can add or remove their listings at any time. For example, if a host isn't seeing the business that they want on Airbnb, they can simply choose to remove their listing at no additional cost. There's an opportunity cost, but there's no marginal cost. Airbnb is ultimately monetizing housing that already exists. So it's not a question of demand or supply, it's just whether or not that housing supply exists on Airbnb. Hotels, on the other hand, are the exact opposite. Demand has to be validated first in order for the housing supply to exist. If the destination is not popular enough to fill the hotel rooms, if the local labor pool is not robust enough, if the land is not available or simply too expensive to purchase, then the hotel will simply not exist. While there are no limits to how many listings there can be on Airbnb, There are hard ceilings on how many hotels can exist based on zoning ordinance. Airbnb is an asset-light, fee-based platform business in an industry that notoriously demands significant capital upfront and capital expenditures. This platform advantage has enabled Airbnb to outperform hotels at scale. Airbnb had 6 million active listings in 2021. If we combine Marriott and Hilton for the sake of comparison and we add these two industry leaders together, we get a total of 2.5 million rooms. That's not even half of Airbnb's listings. Even if we add up all the properties and hotel rooms of the five major players that we've covered earlier, Marriott, Hilton, Hyatt, IHG, and Wyndham, they still don't come close to Airbnb's scale. Between 2020 and 2021, Marriott added 30,000 rooms, Hyatt and Hilton each added 50,000 rooms, Wyndham added 20,000 hotel rooms, and IHG actually shrunk, they closed down 6,000 rooms. In the same exact time frame, Airbnb added 400,000 listings to their platform. Airbnb's scale fuels its top-line revenue. Airbnb's gross revenue in 2021 was $5.9 billion, which beats Hyatt, Wyndham, and IHG by a large margin, and actually puts the tech company slightly ahead of Hilton when it comes to annual earnings. So why aren't hotel executives more scared of Airbnb? Are Hilton, Marriott, and Hyatt executives just pretending not to care publicly, but secretly freaking out in their boardrooms? Are these hotel giants just too stubborn to evolve? The secret is that Hilton, Marriott, Hyatt, Wyndham, IHG, and every hotel giant in the industry, they're actually all asset-light platform businesses who make most of their money on fees just like Airbnb. So while the media and analysts will spin stories about how the hotel industry is dying and about to be disrupted, the reality is that Hilton, Marriott, Hyatt, every big hotel company has been operating exactly like Airbnb long before the startup even existed. Disruption can't happen if the new firm and the old incumbents are all operating in the same way. Most people think of the hotel industry as this deeply traditional, slow-moving business where companies buy the land, hire the staff, build the hotel from the foundations up, and run it themselves until it pays off. And that's true when you look at the roots of the hotel industry, where legendary founders like Conrad Hilton, John Marriott, and Hyatt Robert Van Den owned, managed, and built every single hotel under their names starting from the 1920s to the 1950s. This traditional owner-operated, asset-heavy business model does have some upsides. If the hotel performs well, then the owner directly benefits from all the income generated. If the owner also owns the underlying land, they also benefit from the real estate appreciation, which oftentimes is actually a higher return than running the hotel itself. The challenge with this traditional owner-operated business model is the capital requirements, slow growth, high operating risk, and low cash-on-cash return. Even though the owners can pocket all the income generated under this business model, they also bear all the operating expense and risk of running that hotel. It can take a hotel decades just to break even with its initial investment. And even though the assets like the land and the building carry high book value, hotels are typically cash-starved and desperately need cash flow to offset their daily high operating expenses. Unless the company is backed by credible lenders who can provide significant financial safety nets or cash infusions, it really only takes one underperforming hotel under this asset-heavy, owner-operated business model to pull a company towards bankruptcy. You can see how fragile the traditional owner-operated hotel business model is by looking at Hyatt, Hilton, and Marriott's business performance before and after COVID. In this data set, we just look at the few hotels that these corporations still own and operate themselves. Before COVID, Hyatt and Marriott had clearly achieved economies of scale and were enjoying healthy 20% and above gross margins on its hotels. Hilton wasn't performing as well as Hyatt or Marriott, but they were still in the green with 7% positive margin on the hotels that it was operating. After COVID, a lot of these hotel giants still haven't recovered their economies of scale, they've struggled to maintain consistent guest volume, and the gross margins for the hotels that they directly operate have taken significant hits. Marriott's gross margin for the hotels that it operates dropped to 8%, and Hilton went all the way to negative 14%. When you're in this owner-operated model, reducing variable costs is one of the few levers you have available to reduce your burn rate. But cutting employee hours, eliminating non-essential staff, shutting down amenities, reducing services, lowering these variable costs are simply not enough to maintain your margins when you're already faced with such high fixed costs under this traditional owner-operated model. The critical misconception that many people have today is that Airbnb is the company who pioneered this platform business model in the hotel industry. But in reality, the hotel giants have already been operating as platforms for many decades long before Airbnb even existed. The platform business model is not some new novel idea. Instead, it's an established and well-proven monetization path that has enabled the hotel industry to scale to its current heights today. They're able to achieve faster returns, unlock faster growth, with a lot less capital and operating risk. Just like McDonald's or Subway, Hyatt, Hilton, and Marriott, and really every other major hotel, they all engage in franchising. Under the franchise model, you shoulder the initial startup costs and take on the responsibility for operating the hotel and hiring the staff. In return, you get to brand the hotel as a Hyatt, Hilton, or Marriott, and you tap into an active customer base, you get to write off the brand's prestige, you integrate into the company's tech infrastructure and supply chain, and you get to take part in part of a robust loyalty program like Honors or Bonvoy. And ultimately, if you're a franchisee, you never have to worry about advertising or marketing or whether or not people know about your hotel. If you were a new hotel owner and you were to forge your own independent brand, it would likely be a long and painful journey. You would be buried deep in a sea of other independent hotel brands on aggregators like Hotels.com, Trivago, and Priceline. And since two-thirds of hotel bookings worldwide are for business purposes, there's little chance a business traveler would take the risk staying at an unknown hotel over the consistency, reliability, and reputation of a Hyatt, Hilton, or Marriott. To play out the franchisee example, in exchange for being able to brand your hotel as a Hilton, you kick up 2-6% of your gross booking revenue to Hilton. You also pay a percentage of your gross food and beverage sales along with a monthly program fee up to Hilton. The only upside here is that if you own the land yourself as the franchisee, you still get to keep all this real estate appreciation for yourself. If you're a hands-off owner that doesn't want to take on operations, you can enter into a separate fee-based management arrangement where the hotel giant comes in and manages your hotel for you. It will still be branded as a Hilton, Hyatt, Marriott, whatever hotel you want, but the hotel giant will essentially operate the hotel. They'll hire, train, and manage all your employees on your behalf. In return, the hotel giant will take a percentage of your gross revenue as a management fee. They'll take another percentage as a bonus fee, along with a fixed monthly fee. While you would still be legally recognized as the owner, you would not be responsible or involved day-to-day in any aspect of running the hotel. The catch here with this fee-based management model is that you still have to reimburse Marriott, Hilton, IHG, or whoever for all the operating expenses that they incur running your hotel for you. And that's interestingly enough why cost reimbursement is the biggest contributor to every hotel giant's gross revenue. The traditional owner-operated model is really a relic of the past these days.
The hotel portion is an incredible model. Think about it, Jim. $500 million, half a billion dollars of royalty fee income alone every year. So consistent, and it flows through at 90% margin, generating $450 million of royalty fee income before you get to the management and all the other ways that we could drive this business from a growth standpoint.
Given our asset-light business model and the actions we took during the pandemic to further streamline our operations, we expect permanent margin improvement versus prior peak levels in the range of 400 to 600 basis points over the next few years.
Our fourth quarter results reflect the clear resilience of travel, our strong focus on cost containment, and the benefits of our asset-light business model. Gross fee revenues reached $831 million in the fourth quarter.
Hilton today owns and operates less than 2% of its hotel rooms. Hyatt owns and operates 5% of its hotel rooms. And Wyndham actually owns none of its hotel rooms. They just recently sold off their last two hotels in their fourth quarter of 2021. For Hilton, they make three times as much money from franchise fees than they do from gross bookings at the hotels that they do operate. Marriott makes twice as much money from franchise fees than they do from hotels that they own and operate. Wyndham, on the other hand, is an example of a company that has completely embraced the platform business model with 95% of its hotel rooms under franchise ownership and the remaining 5% under fee-based management. The narrative around Airbnb's disruption and platform business model is intriguing, but it's really not the groundbreaking phenomenon as the media and academics would pose it to be. The entire hotel industry had been undergoing this transition from asset-heavy operators to asset-light, fee-based platforms for decades long before Airbnb existed. In particular, Hilton, IHG, Wyndham, and Marriott have been very aggressive in selling off their hotels and lands to anyone who would buy them every year for the past 20 years. It's really worth noting here that the platform business model in itself is not a silver bullet. While Airbnb continues to outperform the hotel industry in terms of scale and listings, the challenge that the tech company is facing today is the realization that Quantity is not quality. Safety issues, service inconsistency, guest volatility, intrusive hosts, privacy concerns, and excessive policies have resulted in Airbnb travelers feeling more like burdens than guests to their hosts these days. On the flip side, regulation has also caught up. With mandatory city fees, licensing, and permit costs now factored into each booking, Airbnb can no longer use the tagline that they're cheaper or more unique than a hotel when they're already being taxed like one. And since affordability was a major driving force behind the company's early popularity, it's an open question mark as to how Airbnb will navigate these choppy waters ahead. When the playing ground becomes level and price becomes equal across hotels and Airbnbs, service will inevitably become a competitive advantage. The reliability, predictability, and consistency in guest experience is really where hotels have continued to edge out Airbnb across business and leisure travel for the past several decades, and why the industry as a whole doesn't think of Airbnb as a threat.